I'm recording. Best friend, how are you today?
I'm great. I'm ready for another amazing show.
Well, let's get after it. Here comes your intro. Here we go.
All right.
Sharing screen. Every time. Love it.
Yeah, I do too.
Who is our amazing guest today?
Well, we have Mr. Thad Brown on our show today.
Tell us about Mr. Brown.
Well, he is the sports director for WROC Channel 8.
Mm-hmm.
He entered under John Kuchko in 1996 and 97.
Okay.
He's been with News 8 since 2000.
Yeah. Yes.
He worked 1 year covering sports for WBNG in Binghamton, New York. He covers Syracuse, the Sabres, Section 5 High School sports, and the Buffalo Bills.
It's a lot.
Yeah, that's a lot to cover, but that's what happens when you're the sports director.
Yeah, you gotta take care of it all. What else? Yeah.
He loves golf and has covered some of the major championships, too.
Okay.
He played football and lacrosse at New York at a New York athletic powerhouse, Aquinas Institute.
Okay.
They're pretty good, actually. I've heard.
Yeah, they are.
He earned a BA in communications at Hofstra University. And
nice.
You have some facts too, right?
Just one. You know, I thought it was interesting that he attended the Aquinas Institute and played football. I mean, that has been New York's powerhouse. We know how big New York is.
Yeah.
Powerhouse football team for 60, 70 years. Everyone knows about Aquinas football. So, should we let him in?
Yeah, definitely.
We're going to let him in.
All right.
Here we go. And we're off. There he is. There's Mr. Brown right there.
Hi, Mr. Brown.
Hey, guys. How's it going? Thanks for having me on.
Yeah,
thanks for joining us.
You're welcome.
Danny, go ahead.
You ready for my questions?
I'm ready, Zane. This is the only thing I have in my docket for today. I cleared everything out for this part of my day. Which is awesome. Looking forward to it.
Perfect. What are the toughest part of your job?
Toughest part of the job is easily the schedule. You know, in this job, we work nights and weekends. And that's, you know, if you're doing well. When I started, you know, my first 7 or 8 years, I worked every Christmas. I worked my birthday all the time. And even on top of that, you know, you don't know when something might happen. You know, there was one occasion where the Bills fired a general manager on New Year's Eve. So all of a sudden, all the New Year's Eve party, going to see family, watching the ball drop, all that stuff went right out the window. Then also, you guys might remember back on Christmas Eve a few years ago when there was that tragic fire and shooting in Webster. You know, even though that it wasn't a sports thing, that's the kind of large scale story that it's an all hands on deck thing from our point of view. So I remember that morning. You know, Christmas Eve, like it is in many people's house, it's, you know, a bunch of parties and plans and everything. And I woke up and saw the news, and my wife had gone out to go shopping somewhere for the party that day. And before she even came back, I knew I was going in. I didn't even wait for a call. I went and got showered and got dressed and knew I was going into work. And I came home and she was excited. She said, "Oh, you're all ready to go out to church or something tonight." And I said, "No, know, I got to go into work. And, you know, she was unhappy at first, but, you know, you understand when you live that life. So, you know, it's not just the fact that, you know, now I've got a daughter just a little bit older than you, and she plays sports and stuff. And when you have to be on the air at six and work till 11, you know, you miss games and you miss practices and you miss, you know, not a lot. I make it to a lot, but it's not as easy as having a regular 9-to-5 job. So there's no doubt that the hardest part is the schedule.
Yeah, well, I get lucky that my dad did online learning this year, so he was able to do a lot of that.
Well, even, you know, this year, my daughter was home a lot and I was home a lot. So this past year, there's a lot of family time. And I will say, you know, there's a flip side to it. You know, working nights when my daughter was little, you know, preschool age, I was the one that was home all the time, you know, so where a lot of parents, you know, miss all that afternoon time, or, you know, maybe they both working at the same time or they're both home at night. I had a lot of, like, you know, just me and her time, you know, from the time she woke up till 1 or 2 in the afternoon when I went into work. So, you know, that was the good part of it. And the other thing too, and your dad will appreciate this, you know, we didn't really have to do daycare much when we were growing, my daughter was growing up, because I was home in the afternoon, my wife was home at night. We had grandma come over for a couple hours, and there you go. So from an adult point of view, that was a big W.
For sure. Yeah, save on the pocketbook. That's
yes. Yeah, quite a bit.
All right, for my second question, what is your dream job in sports?
Well, you know, I think it's NFL related for sure. You know, I kind of gotten past the point where I'm thinking about a dream job. I really like the job I have. I don't want to call it a dream job because, you know, Rochester, New York, as much fun as it is to work here, it's still a middle-sized market, and you'd like to work at an ESPN or a Fox or something like that. You know, I think the if I had to, maybe instead of a dream job, the dream person for me would be Jim Nance. That guy has the life. You know, he covers the NFL 17 weeks out of the year on Sunday, always doing the biggest and best game. He calls the Super Bowl. He calls the Masters. I'm a huge golf fan, so I love to call that, on top of all the other golf tournaments he'll call during the year. And then he also calls the Final Four of the NCAA tournament. So if I could switch jobs with any one person, Jim Nance would definitely be the guy.
Well, you know, I would do the exact same thing if I could. But I actually have my sights set on professional fishing.
There you go. That's, you know what, and you know, that's a bit of an untapped resource. There's not a whole lot of, you know, big name personalities there. So, you know, go and you know, create your own niche calling that. And, you know, there's enough. The nice thing about media now, you know, when I was your age, there was 3 stations and cable was just like the new brand new thing. Now, you know, you can do internet channels. You can do, you know, Netflix TV. You can be the Hulu fishing guy. There's going to be opportunities for that. So definitely chase that if that's what you want to do.
Yeah. For my third question, what do you think the biggest problems are in sports these days, pro and college?
Biggest problem, you said, Zane? It's a tough one. Let me think. You know, I think that the rush to report stories ASAP is probably, maybe not the biggest, but certainly one of the bigger ones. You know, there's been a lot of situations lately where, you know, something will happen. I think the Kobe Bryant death is probably the best example of that, where, you know, the race to be first on social media kind of obscures the idea that you're trying to be right. You know, as much as, and we all want to be first, we all want to be the fastest with the story, we all want to break the news and get that tweet that everybody retweets, you know, and stuff like that. But the first goal is to try and put the right story out and tell, I mean, the goal of this is to try and, you know, tell people what's really going on, you know, and explain to them accurately, you know, the things that they want to learn and understand and appreciate. And, you know, because the social media world is such a quick reaction, such an immediate, you know, we've got to be first, we've got to be ready to go. That in our business, you know, trying to follow that and be right at the same time, sometimes it's tough to do both. And being able to stay focused on the being right part of it does get lost occasionally. The other thing that's maybe more specific to what exactly I do in local television is that the world of media, like I said before, is changing so fast. You know, there aren't a lot of people, aren't as many people, I should say, who will, you know, in my case, sit around and watch the 11 o'clock news. Just about everybody, you know, gets their news from this thing right here. You know, you just, whenever you want to know something, you look on here. So it doesn't mean that there aren't media or reporting jobs out there or people are interested in what, you know, the stories that I have to say, but it's a whole different format than, you know, just having the news ready to go at 6 and 11. So, you know, wanting to continue to, and there are still viewers that, a lot of viewers that do watch the 6 and 11 o'clock news. So now I'm kind of split between trying to make sure I get my stories on for those TV shows, but also appeasing the people who are going to, you know, get their news from the internet and the phone, you know, and I don't know if I'd call that a problem, but certainly a big enough change that, you know, anyone who keeps an eye on media or follows media knows, even, you know, if you compare media now to 10, 15 years ago, when Twitter wasn't a thing, when, you know, Instagram wasn't a thing, or even TikTok wasn't a thing, it's entirely different. Well, just imagine what it's going to be like 10 years from now. You know, the wheels of progress don't get slower, they get faster. So whatever crazy things you think happen in the next 10 years, whatever the next 10 years, it's probably going to be crazier. And for us to keep up with it and, you know, stay relevant and stay employed, it is a heck of a challenge right now to try to keep up with all that stuff.
Yeah, that's a great answer.
Thanks, Ben.
Bonus question.
Nice.
What is your favorite sports memory growing up?
Are we talking as a professional person or as a kid?
As a kid.
All right. First of all, I grew up a fan of the Jets in football, the Sixers, the Brewers, and the Jets in hockey. So I currently have a streak going right now of 147 seasons. I've kept track of where my teams have never won a championship. So from that point of view, there are very few good young memories. I think my best one was in high school. I went to Aquinas. I'm actually wearing Aquinas shirt right now. And our rival is McQuaid. For those of you in Rochester, you guys all know this. Everybody else, that's our natural rival. So my senior year, we played against McQuaid at one of the college stadiums, University of Rochester. So not just high school field, big stands, had AstroTurf field. We all had to buy, you know, special shoes to play in this one game. And at the end of the half, we're driving downfield, got down to the 3-yard line, and we called a play action pass. I was a tight end, and I caught a touchdown pass against McQuaid, my only touchdown my senior year. But it was a big one. Gave us the lead at halftime. We ended up winning by 2 points. The next day, the picture of me celebrating with one of our offensive tackles was like all over the sports section. Says right there, Thad Brown catches a touchdown pass, blah, blah, blah. So that was probably certainly one of the biggest. I don't know if it's the biggest, but definitely one that I like to think about. And the funny thing now is, Zane, so there's video. One of the local stations was at the game, and they shot it from – way up high in the stands. You couldn't quite, it wasn't too close. And the catch I made, I had to dive on the ground and kind of just pick it off the ground. So my friends like to harass me and tell me that I didn't really catch the ball, that it hopped before I caught it. So every time this comes up, they're always like, yeah, but you didn't really catch it, right? I'm like, no, I really absolutely caught it, 100%. But regardless, my friends still, you know, enjoy the fact they don't have to believe me and can still give me garbage about the fact that it wasn't really a catch, even though it definitely was.
That's what good friends do.
Yeah, exactly. You're 100% right.
You and Franco Harris.
Well, you know, his is a whole different story because he might not have really caught that ball. I mean, that's a different thing where it's a rules discussion and all that. But, you know, his catch goes down in the lower as a catch, kind of the opposite of mine. Like, his catch might not have really happened. Everybody says it does. My catch really did happen, and my friends say it didn't. So I guess in that way, I'm kind of the same.
Yeah, you got the – the other guy got the better part of that end.
Yeah, well, I mean, Franco Harris got the better part of a lot of things, Zane, when it comes to football. So that's just one of the small ones.
He really did. What do you have, yeah. 4 rings with the Steelers?
Right. The talent to play, the money, all that stuff. But that's all right. That's all right. You know, he's lucky enough to get it. He also worked really hard to get it, too. You know, I've come to understand that when you're a professional athlete, the work you put in is beyond what anybody can imagine. So – total respect for that. No jealousy or anything like that at all. Those guys all earn their money in their spots.
Thad, yeah. Quick question before we let you go. Who was your coach at Aquinas when you were playing there?
Joe Muno. He's moved on to principalness at a few different schools. I don't know what exactly he's doing now, but
he's always working.
That's 100% true. He's always working, always helping kids. So had a good, you know, definitely enjoyed my football time for sure.
Well, that's great. I wanted to let you know, and I think you do know, Zane had, I know you're a golf fan, former Ryder Cup member Ken Green on his show.
Very nice. And, well, which Ryder Cup was he, Zane?
You remember, bud? I think I do.
1984?
Close. I think it was 89.
You're close.
So yeah, he was a great guest, nice guy. Boy, he had a rough run of things with you know, some accidents and losing his leg, and the guy just keeps battling. And it was great message that he gave Zane, some great advice on life and stuff. If you could cover one of the majors in golf, only one, which one would you cover?
The Masters, without a doubt. I mean, the lore of that course and that event. And, you know, the other thing about that, too, is of all the majors, you know, and I love golf and watch them all every year. You watch the Masters enough, you know that course by heart. Like, you know, one is a semi-easy par four. Two is a reachable five down the hill. You know, three is a really short par four. So I go 1 through 18 and describe all the holes to you. To see them in person and to cover an event there would be fantastic. You know, and it's different than all the other majors. I mean, I have an idea what Pinehurst looks like, or, you know, Torrey Pines or Pebble Beach, some of the more famous courses. But that course is so ingrained. To be there in person and be a part of one of those events would be fantastic.
It'll happen. It'll happen someday.
I hope so. I'll definitely go at some point. That's for sure.
All right, buddy. Well, Mr. Brown's on the clock. Why don't you say your thank yous and goodbyes, and we will pick it up from here.
All right. Well, thanks for being on my show, Mr. Brown, and spending time with me.
No problems, Abe. Before I go, let me ask you one question. Yes. So you've done all these interviews with all these, you know, big time sports personalities, athletes, coaches, whatever. And the thing that I always try to impress upon people is that as much as these guys are heroes and superstars and people on your fantasy team, you know, when you get talking to them, you realize that they're also just really people, you know, like you and me. So from that point of view, what's the one thing you've learned, or maybe that's been surprising to you, about one of these men or women that you've interviewed that has nothing to do with the sport they played, and more, maybe just more about, you know, who they are as a person, how they've lived, you know, what they've had to go through, that you don't see on TV or you don't read on the back of a baseball or a football card?
Yeah, well, I think I would go with Mr. Green, because he had to, you know, work through all, you know, losing his leg, you know, not many people know this, but he fought a gator when he was little, and, you know, he had to fight through, you know, that car accident, and I think that's really cool.
That's a good answer. And that's a good thing to remember, you know, that I'd always try to, you know, appreciate the fact that, you know, these guys are they're adversaries, you know, because you're trying to kind of get stuff out of them. You know, you want to get the good answers, the interesting information out of them a little bit, but they're just people, you know, and they have moms and dads and brothers and sisters and sons and daughters. And, you know, they just want to protect them and love them the same way we do. And, you know, always try to remember that, you know, when I'm, you know, grilling a guy about some topic. So, definitely a good important lesson to learn.
And I tell you what, because he's been around since I think age six, a lot of these people, I brought him to games because of my sports background and some connections. He just views them as regular people, you know, opposed to probably, you know, most kids his age, you know, might be starstruck or something like that. He's just like, hey, oh, Jim Valvano's daughter. Sure, well, let's just chat, you know. And I'm like, this is Jim Valvano's daughter.
Right.
Into coaching, Jimmy V. That's why I got into coaching. 1983, I watched it. So yeah, it's been great, and he has learned a lot. So we take a little bit from every episode and just add it on to building the life skills and just another moment. So. We appreciate your time, my friend.
Yeah, no problem. That's exactly the way to do it. And thanks for keeping me, including me as a part of this.
You got it. And we know you caught that ball. We know it.
Thanks, guys. I appreciate that.
We'll see you at that. Thanks. Bye-bye.
See you guys. Yep.
Bye.
All right.
He was amazing.
He caught that. He caught that ball.
He caught that ball.
You can tell by how someone tells a story. He definitely caught it. Frank O'Hara, and I don't think you have seen this highlight. I believe it was a playoff game. It was the end of the game where one of the receivers got absolutely drilled on the Steelers. As he was catching the ball, went flying in the air, and he was their star running back, and scooped it before it hit the ground and ran in for a touchdown. Wow. Yeah, I'll have to show you it after we're done with the show.
And, And that story where his friends were telling you didn't catch that ball. I can relate to some of the stories where you've told me with your friends.
Oh, yeah. You got to give your friends a hard time, even if you know he caught it.
Yes.
What is the last segment? And I'm excited about the last segment.
Well, we have best of the week.
What is best of the week, buddy?
Well, it's Italy winning the Euros. You probably already saw it, but yep. Here it is. Show the front. Show the front.
We got to show it. Showing the love. Yeah. And, of course, hold on. There we go.
Yeah.
Warm-ups. And we have over here. There we go. The Italian national jersey that was brought back by cousin Andy. Pretty awesome.
It is.
What was your favorite part of that game? Because we watched it together.
Well, it was probably the end of the shootouts where they won. Because yeah.
Everyone was excited. I'd like to see them stop the penalty kicks and just take a guy off every 5 minutes. That's what I'd like to see.
That would be pretty cool. Like in extra time, they would take
him off. In extra time, every 5 minutes, a guy has to come off the field. And each coach has to tell you, they got to say who's coming off first. They don't even get to see who the other coaches pick is coming off first. So it's a lot of strategy. Like, you take your defenders off first. You take your offensive stars off first.
Take your goalie off first.
No, you're going to leave your goalie in, obviously.
Yeah, probably. That'll probably be last. If there is a last.
Great stuff from Thad Brown today.
Yeah.
Loved it.
I did too.
Anything else? You going to sign off? And then we'll do your song?
Yeah. As Jimmy Valvano said, don't give up. Don't ever give up. Bye.
Love you, man. Great show.
Yeah.
Here we go. You've had a lot of guests on that have said some great things and have overcome adversity. For years to come, you're going to be able to look back at your shows and see all this cool stuff. You've had stories that I've told you about your own family members not giving up. Pretty cool stuff. All right, my friend. Tonight, Milwaukee. Phoenix, who you taking?
No, this last time, go Suns.
Let's go with the Suns. Love you, buddy. Keep it up.
All right. See you. Bye.
Bye, everybody.
See ya.